also need to get.
Yeah, while Ravi prepares it, guys, the workshop will be recorded and it will be available for your reference later on our YouTube channels. So you could subscribe to that channel and stay updated on the earlier workshops as well.
Thanks, Adip. So just to kind of bring a focus, a very sharp focus to what will really be covered today, because we do multiple workshops on funding, and there's a workshop that we do on funding where we help you figure out how do you arrive at valuation of your company, and then how do you negotiate that valuation with the investor. That won't be the scope today, because we had a number of people asking us about what specific actions should they take to get a funder. So today's focus is going to be more on, you know, what specific actions will you need to take to get funded. And just to move on, I see a lot of new names, so I would quickly like to introduce to you what is our philosophy. What does Bulletproof Your Startup really do, and what is its context for doing what it is doing? When we started Bulletproof Your Startup, the question we tried to answer is, why do 95% startups fail? Because unless we understand the problem, what problem are we solving? We will never get the solution right. And our understanding was that there's a cultural difference between Indians and the Western world. And so BWise was set up specifically in September 2018 to address high failure rates that has beset startups. The starting of set of premises were that culturally Indian youths are encouraged to seek jobs rather than entrepreneurship. Consequently, they are not trained or coached to be an entrepreneur. They would rather do than think, plan, and execute. It's always easier to do something. Consequently, their ability to think through and problem solve is not developed with an entrepreneur mindset. So it's not that you haven't done problem solving in your colleges or in your jobs, you have, but that mindset is very different. Also culturally, we've been taught to be more realistic rather than about the realities of our life and how important it is to quickly start earning, rather than to be in touch with our emotions and follow our passion. Consequently, we really don't give a very large attention or focus to following our dreams. And very often dream becomes a hobby, because job takes over your life. Our understanding of the Western entrepreneurship system is slightly different. Young children are encouraged to be entrepreneurs right from childhood, if they show inclination and initiative. I often cite an example of Bill Gross, who's a very successful investor, serial entrepreneur. And he's also set up a incubation center called the Ideas Lab, which has turned out number of successful startups, businesses. At the age of 12, he went to his father and said, I would like to start a candy stand next to a bus stop. Father took out $100 and said, okay, here's your $100. Go ahead and do it. But I will take 25% share of your profit, because I'm giving you $100 and you have to return $100. I think the father did two very important things. A, he encouraged entrepreneurship. B, he taught him value of money, that money is not free. The other thing we've seen in Western culture is that they make liberal use of thought frameworks, business models, business tools, and coaching. I find it very interesting that if I asked a non-swimmer to jump into the deep side of the pool and start swimming, he's not going to do it, because he's going to tell me he's not trained for swimming. And yet, we find thousands of young people jumping into starting a business, which is far more complex, because they don't realize the complexity they are going to face, because nothing in their training, education, life has taught them that this is tough. This is not easy. Then the other thing we noticed is there is very high degree of customer centricity and value creation. Almost every Western entrepreneur we have interacted with asks one fundamental question always. What is the problem that I'm solving for the customer? How critical is it? What value will I give him? These are three questions we find most Indian entrepreneurs don't answer. They are so product focused. Okay, I'll build this product and I will then sell this product, which is really coming from your own perception. It's not what the market hasn't told you that it needs this product. Again, they have very highly evolved communication skills and marketing capability. And that is because in all their lives, they've been taught to communicate their thoughts, their emotions, and that really makes them very good at it. I can't imagine what percentage of Indian parents ask their children to express their thoughts, their emotions, what are they feeling, what are their passions. And I think that sets the context for India. So our problem statement is, in order for the Indian startup entrepreneur to be successful, he needs to be coached using combination of thought and business frameworks to help him strategize, then create, execute, review, and refine his operations plan in a structured manner that covers his complete entrepreneurial journey from the time he gets an idea till he has created a growing company. This is our problem statement. This is the problem we are solving in Bulletproof Your Startup. So what is our solution to this? We've created a five chasms journey framework, business evolution framework that leverages well-established international frameworks. As well as proprietary business frameworks that we have developed. Five chasms journey framework is a proprietary framework to help entrepreneur convert his idea into a successful company. So this is what the five chasms framework really is. It actually identifies not five, but six critical stages. But we talk of five because they are relevant for running business that has started. But your first difficult area is figuring out whether an idea is really an opportunity. And then whether there are customers for the idea that you are trying to implement. We call it the customer development stage. This is the first gap. A lot of startups fail here itself. Following which, okay, you got some customers, but can you go to a larger segment of customers and expand your product? This we call product go-to-market fit gap. After that, if you discovered more customers, you're succeeding, then have you discovered a business model? Which means, you know how you will make money? Have you established your systems and processes to run the company successfully? If you've done that, then post that, do you have the right go-to-market strategy in place to really grow the company? And then a growth strategy in place. So these are the different areas where we have found startups fail. And we have created this framework so that all the points of failure are covered and startups get maximum support to succeed. But the key thing is, unlike anybody else, and I believe I'm told that this is a very unique method that we are following, we rely heavily on frameworks. As you will see in this during this workshop also, we'll keep taking you to frameworks and show you how you need to think through them. Okay, so how do we engage with entrepreneurs? What we figured was that, you know, because this is a very different approach. First of all, people need to be familiar with thought frameworks, how to think through them. So we do workshops. Close to 3,000 entrepreneurs have attended our workshops. And this is one such workshop. This really helps you understand our methodologies. And very often entrepreneurs learn enough and start changing their direction and start implementing what we share in a workshop. We have a number of entrepreneurs who have been very successful by just attending workshops. For those who have attended our workshops, we then do one-on-one coach insight. Close to 300 entrepreneurs have done this. One-on-one coach insight deep dives into a specific issue you're facing in your journey. It will do root cause analysis using frameworks, figure out what is not working, and then create a solution for you in conversation with you, because you are the CEO. You have to decide what works for you, what doesn't work for you. And then we handhold you for a couple of weeks so that we make sure that you are implementing what the advice that you've got. We've recently introduced another product, which is strategy design. This is a 3-month engagement where we work with you on any one chasm that 5 chasms cover, where you are stuck and you need to actually, you need help to cross that stage. So strategy design is actually designed to help you do that. And finally, we have what we call end-to-end deep coaching, where we engage with the startup right through his journey till he reaches, crosses a VC stage and becomes a successful company. So clearly, this is how we engage with companies, with entrepreneurs. Moving on quickly, core team. Myself, Ravi Chalu, I'm an IIT Kanpur graduate, been a serial entrepreneur, and been working in IT sector for all my life. Anupama Singh, 17 plus years experience, again from IIT Kanpur, 9 plus years entrepreneurial experience, has successfully exited a couple of startups, and now she's on her third. Sudhir Bhattacharya, 18 plus years experience, very deep technology experience, 8 plus years in co-founding 3 startups, has exited 2 successfully. Apart from this, we have a team of facilitators and domain experts, about 12 of them, who come in for specific assignments to help help an entrepreneur in a specific area. Okay. Today's agenda, what will we really cover for you? So what we'll also do in today's agenda, we will take some of your questions and we will actually apply the frameworks that we are talking about and help you think through that specific problem. Okay. First question, what should you really do to prepare for getting funded? You're not just going to get funded. You'll have to prepare yourself. Think of it as an Olympic competition where you'll be chosen for a prize. You'll have to spend in time training and working on getting ready for it. It's not going to happen by itself. What type of funds are required for your startup? Very often people don't distinguish between operations and growth. You require money in a company for 3 different reasons. Setup, operations, and growth. And very often people confuse operations funding with equity funding and make mistakes of borrowing money for operations and giving up equity. The biggest mistake. So we'll cover that. Which type of investor should you really choose? Which type of fund should you really choose? Depending on your requirement. Very important. Don't blindly start changing angel investors and VCs and seed funders, because you have options. When should you really approach an investor? So usually what happens here is those entrepreneurs who don't have a business plan and a financial plan in place, they will start chasing investors the moment they realize they're running out of funds. One of the worst situations to be in, because you have got into a competition you have not prepared for and you will run out of breath. That's given. Moving on, how much funding should you seek? Our recommendation normally to entrepreneurs is 0. Build a company where you don't need funding, because that there can be nothing better than that. But you really should seek funding for a, depending on the purpose you require it for. Purpose becomes very important. So we'll cover that. And finally, a to-do list. And most often, you know, entrepreneurs do ask us, "Acha, mujhe karna kya hai?" So there's a to-do list for each stage where we are recommending a set of actions you need to take in order to, you know, create a situation where you will receive funds. But before anything else, it's very important that we understand the nature of our business. What is a startup really? And what makes it fundable? So quickly looking at government definition of it, this is what Government of India says, that it is an entity which is not older than 5 years and does not have turnover exceeding 25 crores. According to me, this is nonsense. I mean, if you are doing 25 crores, you're already on your way. You're funded, you're on your way. But really, this is the key to the identity. And I'm very, very impressed with government that they got this line in. It is somebody who's innovating, developing, deploying, and commercializing new products, process, or service driven by technology or intellectual property. These four words are very important for you. Innovate, develop, deploy, and commercialize. And there is a further qualification we have added to this. You could be opening a new geography or a new customer segment. Example, Flipkart. Amazon started selling books in the US online. Flipkart did exact same thing. There was no innovation in that from that perspective. But they did it in a new geography to a new customer segment. And they became successful. So therefore, if this is the definition of the startup, then critical questions you have to ask yourself to establish value of your enterprise. What will you be innovating? Is it going to be a product or a service? Are you going to innovate a business model? Or are you going to innovate a business process? Let's take an example of business process. Redbus is the best example. They innovated the process of booking tickets, bus tickets. And in the process, they solved an unsold inventory problem for tour operators, bus operators, and unavailability for customers. Two problems solved. How did they start? They asked one question. How can we make tickets easily available to passengers who get disappointed chasing up with travel agents? They defined the problem and then they found a solution. So it's very important for you to have this clarity. What will you be innovating? Or the revenue model. There are a number of examples. Freemium, premium is an example of that. Changing from license model to subscription model is another example of that. What will it be driven by? New technology or intellectual property? Will it be new market segment or geography? Those of you who have interest in e-commerce would have seen that Meesho has become very successful in tier 2, tier 3 towns. It does exactly what any other e-commerce company does in tier 1 towns, but they went to a different geography. The best example of this is Jio, Reliance Jio. So they innovated the product, they innovated the service, they brought in new technology, and they opened new market segments. They did everything. And no wonder it became so successful. Of course, they had tons of money to do this, which you may or may not have. So I'm going to pause here and I'm going to ask those of you who are interested in interacting to type out a chat on chat that what are you really innovating? Is it a product, service, business model? What will it be driven by? And will it be new? We'll pick up an interesting case and talk about it. Anybody on chat?
There's one from Shashank, Automotive Service. Is the Saurav says send bulk payments in real time.
So what are you innovating? Product, service, business model, revenue models? What are you innovating? Process? You're telling me what you will do. You're not telling me what are you innovating.
So Shashank and Rohan says fresh fruits and veggies, e-commerce. Shashank and Rohan say services, innovation. Saurabh says business model. Preeti says I'm in travel industry from B2C, want to move to B2B. Shriram, educational app.
Okay. Now, I think there are 24 participants, right?
Yeah. No, go one by one.
No. The question I want to ask of you, is this the first time you thought about this? that what are we innovating? If you have, this is the first time you thought about it, you have a problem on your hand. Because unless you can very clearly specify what are you innovating, you will be clueless about the problem that you're solving and whether it's a real problem. And why would then your innovation be successful? Because without that, you really don't know whether you're solving a big problem, big enough problem or not. So what will you be innovating? Very important. I'm going to move past this. I'm going to move to another set. So answering these questions is critical as they will determine your business strategy, funding strategy, go-to-market strategy, revenue model, and business model. How many of you have started thinking of these five things? Because if you haven't, how are you going to create your business plan? And without a business plan, how are you going to get funded? So in order to get funded, this slide becomes extremely critical for you. You should have thought about these things so that you can have a business plan in place. Of course, the maturity of business plan will be dependent on the maturity of your company. Are you still in discovery stage? Are you in development stage? What stage are you in? But at all stages, you will need some form of business plan. It is your roadmap. If you don't have a roadmap, you don't even know where you will end up. You can't decide to go from Bangalore to Bombay and start just driving without using a map or figuring out where you will stop and what time you will arrive. Would you do that? You would never start driving. We'll figure out what turn to take, which road to follow. There has to be a map for your business. And I'm surprised why people don't do it. The reason probably why people don't do it, that it is not easy to build. It is a very difficult exercise because there is no structure to it. How do you figure out a business plan? Which is exactly the problem we solve at Bulletproof Your Startup. We create that structure. So that for you to creating a business plan becomes very, 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 a far more easy exercise. Okay, next question. How will you be different? Fine. Okay, you're innovating, but how are you different? So will you truly disrupt the market? How? If you don't have an answer to this question, you will not be able to position yourself well or differently to the investor. So Uber, Ola, Redbus, they clearly disrupted the market, which is why they became so successful. Byju's disrupted the market, became successful. UrbanClap disrupted the market, became successful. How will you disrupt the market? And disruption means doing things in a manner nobody has done before. That is true disruption. So the question you'll have to ask yourself, is my solution helping the customer do things in a manner which is much better and no one has done before? If you don't have an answer to that question, you have a problem on your hand. Because funding will happen very, very quickly for anything that is disruptive. And believe me, VCs can smell that. 90% of the time, they'll pick up a venture which is going to be disruptive. 10%, they may not just get it. But 90%, they'll pick it up. Or are you just going to make sustainable improvement? So let's understand sustainable improvement. So when a company comes out with a faster processor, laptop, or more memory, or more hard disk, it's a sustainable improvement. Or comes out with a display which is bigger, thinner laptop. These are sustainable improvements. Your competition will very quickly catch up with you. In the next cycle, 6 months, 1 year, catch up with you. But Gorilla Glass is not something anybody can catch up with. So Corning has made a huge market for themselves by just doing Gorilla Glass. Or are you just driving efficiency in the market? Okay, some other customer is taking, some other product takes 5 minutes to do something, you do it in 3 minutes. If you're in hyperlocal delivery, your competition is delivering in 20 minutes, you deliver in 18 minutes. Yeah, it is better, but it's not defensible. and VCs and funders can see that and you will not get funded. Is it a business? Yeah, sure, it is a business. Will it get funded by risk investors? No, it will not. It will probably get funded by a bank. So having that clarity becomes very important, that what are you really disrupting? And if you don't have an answer to this, these two slides that I showed you, your pitch deck will not be impactful. So let us look at startup definition from risk funding perspective. I gave you the government definition, and that brought us to those two critical slides that if you have to innovate, develop, deploy, and commercialize, then these are the things you need to be doing. But let us see, how does funding perspective work? So first of all, stop calling yourself a startup. You're a business. You are not a startup. What is startup? Every business that starts is a startup. But in your case, the difference is if you are doing something no one has done before, then you are a business with an uncertain future, which is why you don't get money easily, because your future is not clear. This is a definition, incidentally, we at Bulletproof Your Startup have created. And you have set your business up for addressing a problem a customer is facing. So before you even think about a product, you should have a clear definition of the problem that the customer is facing. Why is he facing that problem? He's trying to do some job. People don't buy products and services in vacuum. You don't say, "Arey yaar, aaj urban clap use karte hain." It doesn't work that way. You have an electrical problem. You have a job to do. You need to repair, so get something repaired. You call urban clap. So please don't put product before the job or job before the problem. Figure out what the problem is in a manner no one has addressed earlier. Very critical. Because if these three things don't apply to you, you are not a startup that will attract funding. You are a regular business. And you are doing this based on a set of hypotheses about how to address those problems. You say, okay, if I solve these problems in this manner, then I will have millions of customers who would want to take this product. Now it's a set of hypotheses. So now because it is a hypothesis, you'll have to test it. You can't start putting all your money into building the product, which is what most entrepreneurs do. Giving an example, there's a very, very, very successful online shoe company set up called Zappos. The entrepreneur, I think, started it in 2003 or 4. And he was just looking at, he was just walking in the market and he was looking at shoe shops, and he realized that there are far many more shoe manufacturers than brands displayed in a shop. So he identified a problem. He said, can I create some solution where more brands can be accessible to the customer without my carrying that much inventory? Because he realized that any shop cannot carry so much inventory. It will become impossible for him to be successful. So he said, okay, let me test it. Can I create an online platform where I can create offer shoes for purchase without really having inventory? So he had a hypothesis that if I do this, I will solve the problem. So how did he test it? He went to these shoe shops and offered them that he would sell their shoes online if they gave him a commission. So he organized a revenue line, and shoe shops had nothing to lose. They said, okay, additional revenue, we don't have to spend any money. So he went and took photographs of multiple photographs of shoes stocked by each shop for multiple shops. And he published it on the net. So now he had ready inventory to sell. And he started selling shoes online without carrying inventory. The moment he would get an order, he would go to the shop. He would check his database and find out from which shop had he actually got the shoe photograph. And he would, based on that order, he would go to that shop, give the money, pick the product, package it, because he's received the money. pick the product, package it, and ship it. Till he reached 1,000 orders a month. Then he realized that, yes, this model works. And that's when he went to funding and got $500,000. This is what we mean by proving your hypotheses. You'll have to do MVPs, POCs, small activities which help you establish that you seem to have a winner. And if you address the problem successfully within a defined business model, you have to discover your business model also. Then it should have the possibility of making humongous future profits. If these things happen, then you have a really successful startup in your hand and you probably have a unicorn. But without having possibility of generating humongous future profits, you are not going to get serious funding. You're a regular business. Nothing wrong with that. But then set your expectations accordingly. Okay, moving on. So what does this definition tell us? Must have ideas filter. Create a compelling breakthrough opportunity through disruptive innovation, disruptive business model, or disruptive technology, or a disruptive service, but disruptive. This is what we covered from the first definition based on government's definition. Pick up a big fight. It might be innovative, but if you're doing it for a very small number of people, you're not going to get funded. It's a David versus Goliath situation. You are fighting something big. And believe me, the effort required for a big fight or a small fight for an entrepreneur is exactly the same. You spend the same 16 hours in office. So pick up a big fight. And focus on creating a large sticky community, which is have very high customer centricity. Make sure you're delivering value to customer. They stay onto your platform. Because without that focus, sticky community is not going to get created. Okay, so based on the two definitions of startups, we now know, okay, in order to create a really fundable startup, what should you really achieve? If you don't achieve this, you will still get funded probably if you have a successful business, but the source will change. It will no longer be VC funding. And we'll look at that as we go along. So because you have to create a big community, so you have to ask yourself, what will drive traction? So are you going to be serving a latent critical need? Becomes a very important question. Because if you're serving a latent critical need like Redbus did, like Apple did with iPod or iPhone, then you really have an access to a big market. Because as you keep growing, giving out solutions, people will realize that, wow, this is really solving a fundamental problem I had. Are you solving an unworkable problem or an unavoidable problem or an urgent problem or an underserved problem? You need to understand that part of your business to get funded. When iPod was launched, people could not download safe music from internet. iPod solved that problem. They could not legally download one song at a time. iPod solved that problem. It was unworkable earlier. So you need to figure that out. What is the nature of problem? Unavoidable is you can postpone it for some time, but ultimately you'll have to solve it. Urgent is you need to solve it, but you can live with it for some time, some more time. Underserved is doesn't matter. It is a problem, but it's not fine. Even if you carry on with it, life is okay. Nothing is going to break. So need to figure out the nature of problem. These are all actually coming out of frameworks that we use to help you figure out whether you have the right opportunity. Or are you just automating a task, making it more efficient? This is perhaps the least fundable situation you will probably be encountering. What will drive your revenues? What is your pricing strategy becomes important. Are you going to be competing with incumbents? That is, there is an established giant in the market. You're going to come in at the same price. Then it's going to be very challenging for you. You don't have the same kind of marketing budgets. Or are you going to enter bottom of the market? Which is, come in at a price where your competitor cannot follow you. or compete with what we call non-consumption. Go to areas where there is no consumption of that service or a product. Meesho did that in e-commerce. They went to areas where people were not consuming their service. So five key things that you will have to be very, very sure of before you actually approach any investor. And the next thing you need to examine right up front is how and when will you gain traction? What will be your customer experience as you get into building your company? Very important, because this most entrepreneurs miss. A very interesting research done by one gentleman called Dr. Rogers. He was tasked by American government to discover how would American farmers adopt the new potato seed. And what he discovered was this Gaussian curve. And he figured that initially people buy it for novelty. And those are innovators, people who like to experiment. That's a very small percentage, about 2.5%. Next, early adopters, which is about 13.5% of the market, will buy it because they're looking for competitive advantage. So they will take more risk because they get competitive advantage. The main market finally responds only for benefits, called early conservative, forms about 34%. Then late conservatives, which is really, they buy it because it has benefits, it is easy to use, they buy it. And then there are laggards who form balance percentage, who will buy only when everybody else has bought. Now, interestingly, this research was done in 1960s. And this has been found to be applicable across industries, decade after decade after decade. This is how your customer base will expand. And the reasons why they will buy will also change. Initially, they'll buy for novelty, then for competitive advantage, then for benefits. No entrepreneur builds this into his product roadmap or his marketing plan. You will need to do that. You can't typically, most entrepreneurs will calculate total addressable market. That is a huge number. But guess what? A very small percentage of innovators will respond to your solution initially. So that your real market initially is just the innovators and maybe early adopters, which is just 16% of the total market. Then what is your geographical reach? Where all can you provide service? Becomes another constraint. The biggest chasm, according to Dr. Rogers, comes when you're trying to go from early adopters to your main market. That is where the chasm occurs. And jumping that is not easy, according to him. But let's move on. This is how your sales will grow. There's a fantastic book written by one gentleman called Jeffrey A. Moore, Crossing the Chasm. Please read it. It's a Bible for anybody who's setting up a new business. What does it take to reach your mainstream customers? So initially you have innovators or technology enthusiasts, and then visionaries who see the competitive advantage in your product. But then there's this huge chasm before you move to the main market. Your problem as an entrepreneur is that you do not recognize that there is an early market and there's a mainstream market, and you start planning for the mainstream market. Big mistake. You have to plan for the early market. Stop looking at the main market if you are still starting. You will have to start looking at the smaller market first and focus on that market. And after that, you look at, okay, moving on to the next market. Because startups fail at this stage also. And post that, then if you've successfully grown, then you can think of how do you actually jump across the chasm. So there's a layered approach even to selling and marketing. And if this you don't build into your plan, you're not going to get funded. If a funder realizes that you have thought this through and you have figured out a graded approach to building your market, he will know that you're somebody who is thinking through and is careful about how he's going to grow and use money. So please don't aim at the mainstream market right away, unless you have discovered your business model. as I showed you in the five chasms framework. Focus on customer development and plan for funding accordingly. Don't start spending on the basis of mainstream market and start running out of market money. So your focus, I mean, depending on what stage you are at, ideation, prototyping, technology creation, I mean, forget funding. You are still too nascent, too early. And as far as initial time is concerned, it is a completely market-focused business and product development is your main purpose at this stage. You're maturing your product. If that has reached a certain level, that will help you cross the chasm. And investors can see this in your success or failure, that where are you? What are you really doing? How pragmatic are you about your approach? And that main side is really grow and scale. You have discovered your business model, you've established product market fit, you've done your customer development. That is when you will grow and scale. And that is when you'll get serious money. So please focus here, your first 100 customers. So then now, having looked at all this, so we looked at, you know, what is required for you to, based on how startups are defined, we've seen, okay, what is it that you would need to have in place in order to be able to define a business plan? And you'll have to start defining a business plan at every stage. And typically a full-blown business plan would have these components. But you can't do that from day one. So you will have to definitely start picking up your mission statement, your product description, your marketing plan, your competitor analysis, and your SWOT analysis. And your SWOT analysis will really tell the investor, how are you different? And a very high level financial plan and timeline. So at this stage, at initial stage, when you still are doing customer development, even if you don't have a mature operations plan in place, it's okay. But all other components must be developed to some level of maturity so that you can actually present it. So, okay, now you're ready. Now you're actually, you've done all this stuff. You are now ready to start looking at sources of funds. How am I going to fund my operation? Assumption is that you have a business plan and your financial plan in place. So there are various ways of looking at funding. I mean, I found this picture very, very important to share with you, that you have to start looking at sources of funds, internal sources, external sources, long-term sources, short-term sources, in that terms. For example, operations require short-term sources. Long-term sources could be what we call term loans from banks and could be equity capital from risk investors. So you have options. So let's quickly now look at what are the various sources available to you. And my assumption is that you are a true startup based on the definition that I shared with you. What are the available sources? Before I proceed to this stage, I'm going to take a pause here and take questions. So, Deep, can you help me with the questions? Hello?
Any questions? Any? Yeah, does anyone have any questions at this point?
I'll just grab a glass of water. Give me a moment.
Okay, good for all. Yes.
Okay, so no questions? No one has a question.
Rohan has a question. What is the actual state?
What is the actual?
What is the actual stage you look for funding? Is it an ideation phase?
Oh, great. I think this slide will cover that.
Or once you have traction, that's the question. The second question that there is, since term loan and business loans are not easily available to early startups, what are the new methods to opt for loans?
So I want to take the second question first. Term loans and bank loans are available to startups, and we are working with startups where we have helped them get that. So first of all, please don't give up that thought. The point is you have to go to multiple banks and explore it. And in fact, you'll be surprised. One of the best banks probably to approach is State Bank of India. Yes, you will face a lot of resistance because they don't want to do that work, but they have schemes available for startups. And government is already working on converting startup funding into priority sector loans, which means that banks will have targets to lend to startups. They will have no choice. We are today helping one of our startups negotiate a full loan basket of 1 crore. Sangeeta ka kitna hai, Sudip? 1 crore hai na?
2 crores.
Wow. So with State Bank of India. So please perish this thought that banks are not open to you. Banks are open to you. The only reason why you should go to a VC is when you see potentials of becoming grow large very, very quickly. You have the traction. So you see your, I'm just going to take an example of an app. So you built an app and you're finding that your downloads are increasing at 20% per month. We do a workshop on metrics where we give you, you know, thresholds which will determine whether you are actually having a good traction to grow. So watch out for a metrics workshop which will help you figure that out. But so it really depends on, let us say you've got downloads which are increasing at 10% a week. Fantastic. You're going to be doing 40% growth every month. But you have 90% uninstalls. So now your growth is not actually 40%. It is down to 4%. As against this, let's say you have just 2% growth every week, or let's say 3% growth every week, which is giving you about 12% per month. And you have 3% uninstalls. So you are sitting at 10%. So which is a better business? The one which has net 4% or net 10%? Okay, the apps, they're not uninstalling, but if you find that, you know what, they use it for one or two times and they have stopped using. So usage is not going up. You don't have a proposal. You don't have a winning proposal. But if you find 90% customers actually use the app at least 2-3 times a month, you have a winning proposal. So those are the things that help you decide, do you have traction? So now, if you sense, if you've done your financial project plans and if you've done your customer acquisition thinking using a framework, and you're very clear that this is how the numbers are going to be, then you would see a point where you will need a huge amount of marketing dollars to capture the market. So now you're facing a situation that the nature of funding that you require is not something that banks can understand. They don't understand risk funding because they don't do equity investment. Banks don't do equity investment. Some banks have tried. I think RBL has tried, and one more bank has tried. Yes Bank probably. But it's a very small effort right now because they don't understand equity investment and it doesn't fit into their charter. So you have to go to what we call risk funding, which is angel investors, VCs, PEs, et cetera, et cetera. Actually, PEs are also not risk investors. PEs are so PE investment is very different. PE investment, you're sitting at a 200 crore company, you're making, let's say, snacks. And PEC is an opportunity of taking you to 2,000 crores very, very quickly, 4 years' time. So they bring, and all you need is money. So they bring in money for growth. So if you are in a situation where you see huge amount of traction is possible, but you will lack marketing dollars to grow, that is where, or you will lack operations dollars to go grow, means operation dollars means you have to open multiple offices, you have to hire more people, and bank may not support that because bank does not understand that kind of growth. Yes, then you should look for VC funding. But if it's a regular business, why do you want to waste your equity on getting money? There is enough options available. We'll be discussing that. Going back to Prashant's question, Sudip, can you repeat Prashant's question? The first question.
Yeah. So the first question was, what is the actual, that is Rohan's question.
Rohan, sorry.
What is the actual stage you look for funding? Is it an ideation phase? Or once you have traction? And Saurav had a subsequent similar question, when to start looking for funding?
I want to take Saurav's question first. Rohan, if you can hold on for some more time. I think the criteria, Saurav, is do you have a financial plan? What does your financial plan tell you that when will you need money? If you don't have a financial plan, you'll keep asking this question and then there is no right time. The right time is whenever you think you'll run out of money. Whatever we have shared with you so far is to help you create a financial plan. Because without a financial plan, you don't know. How will you find out, Saurav, how much should you borrow? If you don't have an operations plan in place, if you don't have a business plan in place, you'll never find out. So these decisions come out of your business plan and your financial plan. And these two terms are so foreign to most Indian entrepreneurs because they in their life have never done this. Nobody has told them that they'll need to have a business plan. They need to have a financial plan. And the funny thing, Saurav, is I'll go back to that example of swimming. I don't know whether I mentioned or not. I mean, if I don't know swimming, I will not be persuaded to dive into deep end of pool and start swimming. And even shallow end of pool. But yet for business, we are ready to jump in. And we have no clue that we are actually jumping into an ocean that seems to be peaceful. That's the trouble with oceans. You don't realize the strength of the waves till you are in the ocean. So caution to you guys, have a financial plan in place, Saurav. If you have a financial plan and a business plan in place, that will tell you when will you need money. And even then, the question you will ask yourself, okay, is this for operations or for growth that is not fundable normally? If it is for operations, figure out a new loan agreement with bank. Figure out how can you generate it internally. But if it is truly for growth, which means, you know, marketing dollars or operation dollars or development dollars. So you built a product. Actually, that product required $1 million of investment and you just spent $100,000 so far. You need another $900,000 to build the product quickly in the next 6 months. That's when you take $1 million. Or you want to start operating from multiple cities and you need people, money for people, offices, running expenses, expansion, growth. That's when you take risk funding. Or you need marketing dollars. You want to launch a really massive marketing campaign. That's when you need risk funding. Or you may need all three in combination. You need to work on all three. So you need even more money. That's where the VCs come in. I'll go back to Rohan's question. Can you please come turn on your audio?
Yeah.
Why do you need money at idea stage?
No, actually, we are a startup who have crossed. We are in a scale up phase now. But I wanted to understand, because when we mean idea stage, it is basically like, especially, Western culture only based on the idea they get the funding. And even in nowadays, recently, some of the companies, ex-big company founders and all, they start the company and before anything execution happens, it is at a very nascent stage only, they start getting the funding. Whereas the successful, that's what my follow-up question was on that only. VCs pump in money on a very high burn rate business model than a sustainable model where, you know, you don't make profits. It is just like, you know, pouring water kind of a stuff. So how is that somewhere like, you know, the disconnect was there. So just
okay. I wanted to understand. Okay, two different questions. My guidance to you is that wherever you see an example of somebody getting funded at idea stage, go a little deeper and see why funding happened. Usually funding won't happen at idea stage unless it has a backing of technically very strong founders. So for example, a bunch of professors who've been working on a new technology that will completely replace CRISPR. But they need money to develop that idea. Now there is a background to fund it. So they can get huge funding. I can give you examples of companies who have set up artificial food companies, ventures, who got funding to the extent of few billion dollars. There are companies who are making synthetic meat, you know, out of
plant-based.
They got funded in the stealth mode because the founders had technical background. They had some, and they had a lot of experience and they got funded. So ideas can also get funded, but they get funded when the entrepreneurs have really solid background. They have past entrepreneurial experience. They have exited successfully from some earlier startups. Or they are technically very qualified and they have the experience of building the product that they are saying they'll build. And there also they will have to kind of prepare a very robust case to get funded. We don't see behind the scenes thing that's happening, but typically 99% of the startups usually receive VC funding only after 3 to 5 years of successful operation. And we have very few examples of cases where they receive early funding, where some VC sees a lot of potential. One example, or a VC is a very smart salesman. I mean, the one example I can give you is that lady Elizabeth Watt, who set up that blood testing company. What is the name of the, Sudeep, do you remember? She's now under a lot of investigation and is probably going to go to jail. But her proposition was to do multiple blood tests from one drop of blood. And what was her name? I forget. So you have situations where some founder is a very persuasive personality and he can convince funders, but these are very rare cases. Now coming to VC supporting burn rate, there, Rohan, there is another factor working that there's a lot of cash in the world today. In fact, in terms of printed money, there is 26, if you total up the entire gold reserves of the world, 2600% times that gold reserve is the printed cash lying with private individuals. And that free cash, which was getting invested, well, that was getting invested in other sources like stock markets, real estate, mining, are no longer really giving the kind of return these people look for. So there is a lot of fund available today for where people are looking for really high growth. So how does VC work? VC actually collects maybe $200 million from such individuals who want high rate of return. And VC promises them 14%, 15% annual return or whatever. And then VC has to bank this fund on risky ventures, which give them crazy growth, right? And what is that growth? VC must find a quick exit to a larger VC. Otherwise, he can't continue with that bet too long. So what VCs do is they keep getting a bigger fish and a bigger fish and a bigger fish into the play. And the bigger fish always takes it at a higher multiple. So the moment they take it at a higher multiple, VC has achieved his objective. If he had invested $5 million for 10%, which means the company's worth was $50 million. And company is now worth $500 million. His $5 million has become $50 million. And these are all notional, because somebody who comes in and wants to buy out the stake will have to pay $50 million to VC. And VC has achieved his objective. He's multiplied money for his investors. He has zero interest in whether you will become a sustainable company, whether you will completely change the world, you'll make dent in the world. He doesn't care. All he cares about is, will his money get multiplied? A very different driver. A VC's interests and your interests are not aligned. You may want to build the next Facebook. VC doesn't care. He's only going to see, can I multiply my money in the next 3 years by 10? Yeah, in the process, if you become the next Facebook, great. My money will multiply 1,000 times. But right now, my goal is, can I multiply it by 10? Answers your question, Rohan?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on. Okay, let's look at this. So discovery, the ideation stage, what are your possible sources of funds? And this is what I was asking Rohan, that why do you need money at the ideation stage? Because if you're not willing to put your skin in the game, why should a third party put money in the game? So discovery stage, bootstrapping, you have to bootstrap, you have to find your own money. So save money. If you want to do something, make it a side activity, take a job, make it a side activity, keep working on it. When you find that, yes, invest a very small part in it so that you're not financially stretched. And then once you reach a size where you think, yes, now this actually needs me to step out. Like Dropbox. Dropbox was developed by somebody who had a job and who wanted to store files online. And he figured, okay, why not open this service and give it to people? And today Dropbox, you know what Dropbox is today. So bootstrap. Commit yourself, put your skin in the game, your time and money in the game. That is basic. That is the basic requirement for being successful. And what are you really investing for? You're checking. Does the idea make sense? Is there a large enough problem to solve? It's not about whether you can build the product. I can give it to you in writing that yes, you can build the product. You've done it all your life. You're a programmer, a great programmer somewhere, and you can build a product. But what you don't know as a programmer is there a customer out there who will buy it, who will pay you for it? That is what you don't know, and that is what you have to discover. Do you have a large enough problem to solve? So at this stage, funding is self-funding. Then, okay, you see, okay, the idea makes sense. It probably is a good thing to do, and you should actually take it to customers. Next is development. Look at family and friends and look at incubators. If you're from a college which already has an incubator, work through that incubator. Don't waste your time. Today, incubators give you, at least I know from IIT Kanpur experience, they give you 2 lakhs to, actually 50,000 to 20 lakhs in the incubator to build your solution. And that's a lot of money to have. You may or may not be in college, even if you have passed out and you are working. You can go back to your incubator and use that money to build your product. But please don't make the mistake of not doing the discovery part. Discovery is critical. Whether your idea makes sense and whether there's a large enough problem to solve. So you're really building a prototype at this stage. Use the incubator to build the prototype or use money from family and friends. But at this stage, you will need a rudimentary business plan, a rudimentary pitch deck, and a rudimentary financial plan, which you'll have to tell people, your family and friends also, hey, this is my plan. This is the problem I'm solving. This is my financial plan. This is when I will give you your money back. This is the return you will get. 90% start entrepreneurs don't do that. You've crossed what we call product go to, you've done customer development, you're now reaching that product go to market fit stage. This is the time you can go to an angel investor or you can go to an accelerator. Accelerators are typically an accelerator is a company which can give you a lot of free resource or a free access to market and gives you an opportunity to reach the next level. So Microsoft Accelerator, Oracle Accelerator are great examples of this. But you have to have a tech product which makes sense to that accelerator. Even Target has an accelerator, but then they want you to build things which are relevant for Target. And at this stage, you have a few customers in a pilot stage. And you're not wanting to take it to the next stage. If you have successfully crossed product market fit stage, you're operating, you're getting customers, you actually got early adopters, you started getting some conservative customers from the mainstream market. You're now looking for bridge or seed capital. In your financial plan, you have built that you will now look at bridge or seed capital to help you discover your business model. So you can go to banks or you can go to seed funding at this stage. Because it's a short-term loan, you want money for 6 to 9 months to get to the next stage. Both options are possible for you. Because please remember that angel investor, seed funder, VCs, they will typically take anything from 10 to 20% of the stake. And if you made the mistake of giving 20% plus and you're three founders, you'll be left with less than 20, 25% stake between the three of you. You're down to 8%. So either you build really huge value in the process, then quick devolution doesn't make a difference. If by devolving, you have built a company that is worth 100 million, at 8-9%, you are individually worth $8-9 million. That's a lot of money to make. So we covered this in another funding workshop where we show you how to value and how to devolve, how to give out equity. Okay. So you're discovering business models, so seed funding, bank. And after that, when you're wanting growth, are you going to venture capital or you can still go to a bank? Depending on, are you truly a startup as we give in the two definitions, or are you a regular business? So your business model is established and your traction is visible. So these are broadly various funding stages and what is the criteria that will decide that yes, you will get funded. Okay, let's move on. Now let's spend some time. Sorry, I wanted to make this point to you that you see the ellipse, the circle. Actually, this applies only to a true startup. If you do not conform to the two definitions that we showed you in the beginning, you will not get funded by angels or venture capitals or seed. You will have to go to banks. I also want to kind of start talking to you about what do you really require money for and what is the difference between capital expenditure and operating expenditure and where will that money come from? So in a conventional business, the stages are setup, break-even, operations, growth. And funding options for capital expenditure are equity, loan, grants, if you're a social entity or from operations itself. And for operational expenditure also, it could be equity, loan, grants, or operations, from operations. So typically, this is what will happen in setup. You're going to be bootstrapping. But if you need larger money, somebody might invest in you and you issue what we call convertible notes. You could go to banks and take MTL, medium-term loans, to set up your capital assets. Or you could go for private lending, possible, and it's happening today. In case of social enterprises, I'm not going to focus too much on that, but grants are an option. Go to trust. There are no operations, so nothing is going to come from operations. for operational expenditure, again, bootstrap or take bank limits or private lending. What about break-even? Again, you're bootstrapping. You can take bank loans and private lending, but typically banks will insist that you bring in at least 25-30% of your own capital. But the beauty with banks is that you don't give out equity. Now for operations, you don't need equity because operations is day-to-day running. Your bank loans should have been sufficient to help you run. And because you're operating, our criteria to all startups is that if you're not generating what we call operating profit, not net profit, different from net profit, operating profit month on month, you're doing something wrong. In fact, almost all our startups, our starting condition in coaching is that you have to achieve operating profit within 3 months of operation so that you don't struggle for running your company. And then from operations, there is a finance term called free cash flow. That is money that you actually, cash that you actually generate from a business after taxes and after paying everything. So funding your growth from free cash flow is an option to a regular business. It is only for growth does a conventional business get private equity. Or they could take loans from banks again because they've established credibility and trust. So this is how it works for a conventional business. So let's see what's the difference between a conventional business and a startup. Unfortunately, startups have three stages prior to setup of a regular business. Please don't mistake the setup. Setup means now it's a regular business. For me, that is after you crossed the first three chasms: customer dev, product go-to-market fit, business model discovery. And these three stages are ideation, product market fit, and discover business model. This is different for a startup. And that is why a traditional business, a traditional bank can't understand you. And ideation, bootstrap, or somebody is ready to give you a loan, private lending, it's not going to come from anywhere else in most of the cases. Product market fix, most entrepreneurs try to take funding here. We advise don't. You should have planned this
in Saurabh, are you able to hear? Saurabh, you're mentioning you're not able to hear. Are you able to hear now? Guys, is Ravi audible to all of us?
Yeah, it's very loud and clear.
Yes.
Okay, Saurabh, please check from your side. I think, yeah. Thanks.
So we suggest don't borrow money till very, very late. Even discover business model, don't borrow your money because this will help you conserve cash. Keep bootstrapping. Go to families and friends if need be. But treat equity as a very precious resource. Now you actually are trying to do your go-to-market and you can start borrowing money at this stage, but you will definitely need money beyond this. You'll have to go for seed capital, operation seed capital, finally venture capital. I will not go too deep into it, but I did want to plant this in your mind that there are multiple kinds of expenses and multiple kinds of sources. And please don't treat financing, funding as one black box where you go to an investor and ask for money. If you'll do that, you'll be making a very serious mistake. So therefore, a financial plan, what are you going to spend them on is extremely important. Okay, so by this time, you should be ready to create a pitch deck if you've done all this. And that pitch deck should have at least 9 things. This is a pitch deck recommended by Peter Thiel. Those of you who may not know Peter Thiel, Peter Thiel, Elon Musk were together when they set up PayPal. They founded PayPal. You should be able to define your pitch deck with these 9 elements. We do a workshop on pitch deck where we take you more in detail as to what should go into each slide. Okay, moving on. So how do you raise funds? Now I'm going to come to a to-do list. What will you do? How are we doing on time? Good. The day you have an idea and you're clear what is the industry segment you're going to be in, do your research and start compiling a list of investors. Start examining online funding platforms if they are relevant to you, and there are many. And you can always keep putting, see, the thing is, if you, it's like preparing for an entrance exam, IIT entrance exam. If you start working from 8th class and do a bit every day, it is probably going to be less taxing than trying to do everything in the 12th. So the day you are reasonably sure that your idea is an opportunity, start figuring these things out. There are enough angel investor networks. Start engaging, start finding out what do these angel investors networks do, how do they invest, start understanding. Start participating in events. There are networking events on investment. Some of those webinars cost you money. It doesn't matter, choose smartly and invest. Once the lockdown is removed and physical events start happening, start participating in events. Take time out for this. So my point is, even before you need the money, start doing the work. Start becoming visible. Start making connections. Start making contacts. What will you do on social media? Okay. Get into posting about what you are doing, what is the problem you are solving. Start giving updates. Make yourself visible. Start looking at collaborations with, you know, people who can, they can sponsor your post or they can influence social media on a quid pro quo basis. Don't spend money. Reach out to other startup founders and seek advice and direction. You'll be surprised how many are ready to help. Get into direct messaging if you can get social profile handles of well-fitting investors. I know they may not answer, doesn't matter. But even if one out of 100 answers, you got your at least one contact. That is how it's going to happen. That return is going to be very, very low percentage. Start creating visibility for yourself. If you have reached that stage, TechCrunch, Mashup, Your Story, Medium, Reddit, I mean, there are so many forums. So this is very, very methodical, diligent work that you do day. You block 1 hour of your day to do just this, or 2 hours of your day to just do this. Start visiting Crunchbase and research for relevant investors. Use LinkedIn for cold messages or to seek quality introductions to investors. Use LinkedIn Premium when you are ready and have the budget. Facebook for building meaningful relationships. After, there's so many startup groups. Start interacting. Start building visibility for yourself. Twitter for thoughtful conversations and an engagement with the relevant information shared by the investor. An investor makes a comment. Start posting. Start interacting. Make yourself visible. There are 18 points, so I'm just going to go through those. This is a laundry list. You guys can actually, we'll mail out this list to you. It's going to be there on the YouTube recording. So please make a template for yourself. What will you do? Start blogging. Start writing about what you're doing. Create an email list of people you want to start writing to. They could be influencers. They could be investors. They could be future co-founders. They could be future employees. Make that list. Reach out to incubators that make sense to you. And do this in early stages, because after you cross product, go to market fit, the incubator is not relevant to you. And if you're at product market, go to market fit stage, start looking at accelerators and working with them. Start sharing your product with investors, with influencers, with people who can actually promote your product. Go to top tier business school events. Like IIM Bangalore does a lot of events if you're in Bangalore, and Ahmedabad also does, IIM Calcutta also does. Most of these MBA schools are doing events which bring a lot of investors to the forum. IIT Kanpur does a lot of events. IIT Bombay does a lot of events. I don't know what other, I know about the top five IITs, but I don't know about other IITs, what were regional colleges earlier. What do they do? So, but figure it out from your college. And even if it's not your college, figure out who are doing it in your city. Go start attending those events. And if you've been working, figure out from your industry friends. See who's relevant, start talking to them. You'll be surprised if you reach out how helpful people can be. Don't miss pitching competitions. Go pitch even if you don't have money, even if you don't need money. Why? Because you're practicing for the big day. You will learn with every pitching. What worked, what didn't work, what were the questions, how should you change? And those are fantastic feedbacks for you. Some of them may not be right, but that's okay, ignore that. But even if you get out of 10, even if you get 3 great advice, it's something you gain. Connect to your city's entrepreneurial community. If meetups are happening, when cities open up, meetups are happening, or online communities, start interacting. What about VC funding? Start establishing that your market, if you've done all this, you would have created visibility for yourself and you will be able to point out so many collaterals to VCs. If you've got past entrepreneurial experience, achievement, that's a great credential. Use that. If you've done all this and you built a major name recognition on social media for yourself, you already are a winner. You are recognized socially. Your startup has a huge social media presence. That helps. So work on that from day one. Your product should be working and showing signs of traction. Otherwise, VC funding is not going to happen. Have a defensible business model. Start exploring bank loans and microfinance. Somebody had asked this question, what other alternatives? There are a lot of online microfinance ventures that have been set up. When you create your list, create the list of those entities also. Because those terms of borrowing can be very easy, can lead to lesser equity being given out. But typically they work in the range of 18 to 22% interest. And now it's going to even come down because there's a lot of money that people are trying to give out and there are not enough takers. If you're a social entity, look at government grants and programs. Even for a regular startup, I know that government is providing a lot of money to leading engineering institutions for cutting edge technology. So look at those grants and programs. A lot of it is also happening in agriculture. There are a lot of agriculture grants available for agricultural agri-tech startups. One of our startups that we are deep coaching has just got a 25 lakh grant from one of the agri support organization set up by government. Finally, through your mentors, advisors, and coaches. So you have 18 different activities that you can do to create a platform, create a situation where you get funded. So let's look at each stage. How do you get funded? You're bootstrapping, right? At this stage, apart from bootstrapping, unless you're really exceptional technical personality, technology person, or exceptional entrepreneurial experience, it's going to be challenging raising money from the outside market. So therefore, the first thing you have to do is establish that your idea makes sense, that you are solving a large enough problem. And there's a framework that can help you do that. And that framework actually is what we call jobs to be done framework. It was built in 1990s by a company called Stratagen. And its success rate is 86% across industries, large companies, small companies, startups, very successful framework. And the framework is based on one fundamental question. What is the job for which the customer will hire your feature, product, solution? This question you must ask yourself. Okay, whatever I'm trying to build, what is the job for which the customer will hire your feature, product, or solution? And customer jobs can be of three kinds. It can be functional job. It can be and you will have to figure this out. functional job, emotional job, social job. And what is the basic need? Why is he wanting, what is the issue he's facing that he needs to resolve? So the second framework that we use is the need matrix, the blatant critical matrix. You have to figure out what is the nature of problem visibility. Problem can be latent, problem can be blatant. What is the nature of customer need? Is it aspirational or is it critical? The best opportunity lies here when it is a latent critical need. Remember in one slide, I asked a question, is the need latent critical? The most obvious lies here, blatant critical. The most expensive to support lies here. It'll need huge marketing dollars. This will need huge operational costs, but lesser marketing dollars. So if you do this analysis, you use that framework and do this analysis, you'll have such a sharp idea about whether your idea makes sense. We cover this in great detail in our workshop on idea to opportunity. Is there a large enough problem to solve? Moving on. Okay, what should you do if you're at development stage? So do your research and compile a list of investors and banks, NBFCs, microfinance. You should have started this in discovery stage itself. Start exploring your college incubator or any other college incubator which is ready to take you. If in the first discovery stage you have proven to yourself that it's a great idea, then you can make a great pitch for incubators to take you in. Explore online funding platforms, fundraising platforms, if they are relevant for you. It need not be relevant for everybody because online platforms charge a hefty commission, 15%. So, but three options, bootstrap, use your own money, families and friends, or incubators. Start connecting to angel investor networks right away because you'll need them at the next stage. Start making contacts, start sharing your progress, start talking to them what you're doing, start asking them questions about what should you do so that you start getting that help. Start participating, block a certain amount of your time, 10, 20, 15% of your time for participating in networking events and meetups. Create a presence on social media, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, and start posting. Start posting your progress to your key connects. And make it conversational. Don't make it like a status report. Make it conversational. Because people like conversations. People don't like to be given a report. Explore collaborations with, you know, sponsors, with influencers. And if they can start sponsoring your post, if they can start influencing their audience in your favor, influencers can work for a percentage of commission. Not necessarily upfront flat payment. Reach out to other startup founders and seek advice and direction on funding. Create visibility on, you know, TechCrunch, Mashup, Your Story, Medium. There's so many platforms. Start creating visibility. Start visiting Crunchbase to figure out and research. And I'm taking these points from the original list because not all will be relevant at each stage. Okay, operations. Now it switches to angel investors, accelerators, and banks. And your criteria is you should have a few customers in pilot. If you don't have that, you're not ready for this. Interact with angel investor networks, increase participation in investor meet events, social media. I mean, the points are pretty much same. Start writing blog articles, email to an investor list, explore accelerators if you qualify. Start sharing your product with influencers and investors. Explore investor programs through top-tier business schools. There are enter pitching competitions. Figure out your city's entrepreneurial community and start interacting. Bank loans, microfinance, government grant programs, and there are so many options you have. But there has to be a structure and method to what you do. And hold on. This is an extra slide. Okay. Bridge seed. You should have established product go-to-market fit stage, and now you need to establish biz model. This is the criteria that will qualify you for this. Use angel investor network again, because whosoever is the angel who invested in you uses network. Ask him to connect you to bridge and seed. Increase your email effort. Use accelerator's network if you work with an accelerator. Get into more and more pitching competitions. Milk your city's entrepreneurial community. Bank loans, microfinance. Ask your mentors to help you. So that's pretty much, and if you cross bridge stage, you've got funding. VC funding will happen because the seed funder will take you to VC. So that's the last slide in my presentation. We can take questions now.
No questions at all. So we are so clear. 1 second. We had some earlier questions, Ravi, that we may want to address.
Okay.
So if you just go up the chat, fairly long statement, so you may want to read them.
Hang on, I'm just going to scroll up.
One was by Preeti.
Preeti. Preeti, you can come on. Voice and you can turn your mic on and ask the question. Okay, it looks like Preeti is either not there or the question might have got answered.
Ravi, I have one question.
Yeah, Rohan.
Preeti, you want to come in? You're still there. Okay, she's not coming on.
Audio.
Yeah, Ravi, actually, how important is having the IITN or IIM in the team to get the funding? Do you think it is?
I think anytime you take on a coach or an advisor, you should actually. Oh, sorry, I think you said a founder who's from IIM, right?
Yeah, founding team.
Okay, it helps, but beyond a point, unless the person is adding value. Let me answer it differently. If you already got traction, the team won't matter, whether it's from IIT or IIM or from neighborhood college, because you already got traction. And getting a person specifically from IIT, IIM on board gives you visibility, definitely, because it makes you more visible. It's a tick mark on a investor's list, but it's not a guarantee.
Okay.
Therefore, look for value that the person is adding. Don't take him just because he's in IIT or IIM.
No, one more thing. How do you think of the startups? Because you all told about the basic funding and all that, but you never said about that you work with a startup. What are your services?
Rohan, we initially had a slide where we said we engage with startups in four ways. We do workshops, we do coach insights. And coach insight is really something that we do one-on-one with a startup entrepreneur and his team, where we get deeper into a specific issue that he's facing and analyze using it frameworks and then give him a solution to get past that. So this is a one-time engagement, and you can do multiple coach insights one after other. Then we do what we call strategy design, which is basically designing a strategy for crossing a major stage, which is customer dev or product go-to-market fit or business model discovery or go-to-market strategy or growth. It could be any one of these. So that engagement typically takes about three months, where we actually do a deep dive. We do a diagnostic into the situation. We use your current data and we look at where you are, what's happening, what is data telling us. Based on that, we give you a way forward. Then we work with you to implement it. So that typically lasts for about 3 months. And then we have deep coaching, where actually we become part of your team. We will not be there on the ground for execution, but we'll be there to design the strategy with you, to build your operations plan, your finance plan, your funding plan, and then monitor the operations with you on a weekly basis, just like you do in a professional organization. And keep giving you corrections, you know, tweaks, to make sure that, you know, we are staying true to the original strategy we designed. And in case we are finding that it's not working, then redefine the strategy based on what we learned from the market. So we become like your executive team till such time you can hire one for yourself. Rohan, does that answer your question?
But would it be with an equity or is it a...
So our models are always success based. So for example, Coach Insight and Strategy Design are flat fee models, but deep coaching is success fee based. So there will be a very small monthly fee, but a very large part of our earning will come from a very small equity share. The idea there is we put our skin in the game. So maybe we look at something like 2%, 3% equity and a fixed fee every month. But our goal is that within 2 years, we should have made sufficient valuation for you so that we can earn our success fee. Does that help, Rohan?
So the next question, Redmi, can you tell your name, please? You may want to come on audio. The name Redmi, you have three questions. Can you come on audio, please? Hello?
Hello?
Okay. Yeah, hi.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. That's your name. Can you tell your name, please?
I'm Nikhil Chidam.
Yeah, hi, Nikhil.
Yes. I have two questions. I'm not a startup. Before I start my company, I just share my business card and everything to my friends and relatives. And they are ready to fund me. But my question is, they're asking for the shares in the company. I don't know how much to provide. They're asking for the shares. They're funding around 5 to 10 lakhs. 2 to 3% are funding me. But in this case, how much have to provide the shares to them? That's the first question. And the second question, I don't have a technical team to build a web and Android application, which my business will work on that. So I am thinking to provide it to a third party to work on that. Is that okay as of for now? These are the two questions I want to ask.
Okay. I thought there were two questions, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So as far as the first one is concerned, it's very difficult to say whether it should be 5%, 10%, 20%, 50%. It's a question of what is the value the person is adding at that point in time. So let us say you are desperate. You want to do this business and you want 50 lakhs of rupees. And I say, okay, I'll give you 50 lakhs, but I want 50% stake. Neither of you are right or wrong, and you want to give only 5%. Both of you are right and both of you are wrong. The key here, Nitin, is have you figured out your financial plan? Have you figured out how much money will you need? What will be the equity holding? What valuation are you driving for? Because if you had those numbers, you would then know how much equity should you part with. At what stage? But without that, Nitin, It's a wild guess. I mean, it's negotiating capabilities. And I would not recommend leaving yourself to that kind of a situation where heat of the moment decides what is the money you will get and how much share you will give. What was your second question?
My business works on web and mobile. I don't have a technical team.
So, Nitin, it depends how critical is the code. If your code is the IP, you'll have to have a team. But if your code is not the IP, it's the business model or the business process, then really it doesn't matter. I would say outsource the use a regular platform. Open source, use karo, give somebody a low cost project and build a platform. Get a platform built. Don't build a team to get the platform built. Because that is not, the code is not critical to your business. Code is just helping you carry out a function. So even if somebody copied the code, it doesn't matter. But it's your business process or your business model that's going to make a difference, or your revenue model that's going to make a difference. And once you have money, you can always hire your own team and build your own platform.
So during funding, like, how the investor will think, like, I don't have a technical team, I don't have a technical knowledge, but entire business works on application. So in that case, how can I add how can I show my heritage in the company? Like, I'm the front of the company, and I do whatever I'm like, the marketing and the expansion I can manage. So in this case, do we have to have a technical team in the future when we go to an investor, or before we go to an investor?
So again, it's a depends on what stage you are at. If it's your bootstrap stage, then friends and family may trust you and give you money. If you are at customer development, product go to market fit stage, and an angel investor would want to see, understand your business better. And if it is okay to have your code developed by a third party from business safety perspective, then he will also figure out it doesn't matter, because code is not the key to your business. But if code is the key to your business, then he will insist that you should have a technical person on board. Ideally, we have in our coaching, we actually guide entrepreneurs that you should have three founders. One founder should understand the domain in which the customer domain in which you are solving the problem. The second founder must understand operations. And the third founder must understand sales and marketing. These are three primary functions that you must have. Everything else you can outsource. However, if it's a technology dependent company, that technology is the key, then the product domain person has to be the technology person. This is what we recommend. Mm-hmm. Can we move on to the next question, Sudip?
Yeah. Shashank says, bank loans at what percentage can we ask for?
Shashank, the bank loans typically today are, I think, at 10%, 10.5%. And may come down even further.
Ashwak says, when you say you should have a sufficient number of customers in pilot, can you please quantify it?
Depends
Ashwak,
on your business.
Are you there on the call? Ashwak, are you there on the call? I see you there, but can you come online on the audio? Okay. Arpan says, I've been doing business for some time now, but haven't done it in a way to present data for valuation or for investment. It's proprietorship. What should I do to get started? Can you suggest some way to get on track?
Arpan, we'll have to go get a little deeper into your business. I mean, that statement could be anything. You could be running a fishing operation. You could be building bridges. You could be actually building the...
Can I talk?
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
Hi, Arpan. Hi. Hi, Ravi. So basically, it's small education-based training center that we are running on. And it's a little bit tech oriented. So, and I have been working on building some supporting technologies for that. Now, not really that I want to get into like taking same training business as kind of actual business, but the applications that I'm building for supporting this business can be useful for other training businesses also. That's where I'm looking at.
Sure. So basically building a, let's say, a learning management system.
Yes, kind of.
Yeah. So Arpan, so it's a product that you're using internally, right?
Service that I'm, yeah, not really product, I would say, but a service that we would like to share with others.
Okay. But how will that service run? Will it run off a platform or how does it happen?
Out of platform, yes.
Right. So fundamentally, what you're saying is you'll create a cloud-based platform which people can then use as a service.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. And it's a learning platform.
It's a learning platform.
So you're really at, if I were to view it, you're at a prototype stage where the prototype is working for you.
Yes.
And it need not be a fully mature product because it's your own product and you understand it and you can tweak it.
Right.
So how does the platform reach maturity? You'll have to start finding more customers and start working with them one by one. And till you get maybe 10, 15 further companies who are running programs on your platform. So I would go project by project, mature the platform. Once I have 10, 15 companies running on it, then I would look for funding to grow it.
Okay, so basically, the now there are two things here. One is the platform that I'm building and another is training institute. So based on training institute's revenues and even that, we can scale it up.
So you're trying to kill two birds with, though, please remember, Arpan, there are two, these are two different businesses, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's very difficult to keep a very sharp focus if you're trying to do two different businesses at the same time. And what's going to happen to you is you got to, so services business marketing is very different. Your customer is different. On a platform basis, your if you're providing a learning management system as a platform, your customer is different, your marketing is different. These are two different businesses. I would not advise doing both together. You'll have to take a call. Either you grow as a service provider for students, or you grow as a platform provider for training organizations.
Okay, so in that case, let's talk little bit or suggest more for service for students rather than platform, because platform is at way too nascent stage. Plus, it is kind of still in prototype. I have a little less confidence on that. As
of Fair enough. So Arpan, I would suggest you get into a one-on-one conversation with us where we can probably go a little deeper into what you're trying to do.
Sure. Let's meet.
Okay. Hi, Ravi.
Hi, Fahad.
Yeah, this is Fahad. I am from the same team of Ashwak. Ashwak was asking, there was a mention that there should be some sufficient number of customers in pilot phase. So can you please suggest some specific number if it is the case of the B2C model? So what will be the sufficient numbers of customers to be in pilot?
So, what is your business? What do you do?
It is a e-commerce kind of thing. I think we have had discussion long time back, or you may be remembering that refill model, e-commerce.
Ah, yes. Now I remember. Yeah.
Challenge. It is a B2C model. So, what will be the sufficient?
Fahad, but we discussed your problem lies at the refilling end. Because how do you persuade companies who are manufacturing product to use you as a refiller?
Yeah, that is a different that we are figuring out, and we have some roadmap. So our current question is how we can say it is a sufficient number of pilot customer. So what will be the that size of the customer in the pilot phase?
I think Fahad, if it's the same business.
Or let me say that now we have around 75 customers. Sorry.
The problem doesn't change because at the end of the day, you are changing the packaging method, right?
Yeah, correct.
For the manufacturer, you're changing the packaging method. So it is the manufacturer who has to buy into your proposal. Even if you get one manufacturer to sign up with you.
Yeah, that's what it is. So we are getting the roadmap to that. We got a few of the local manufacturers and we are getting to that way. But yeah, it is a long journey to get the big brands to in our plane. But we have some roadmap. So our question was, let me clarify other way. We have some 75 plus repeating customer now from the gated communities. So that will be sufficient number, or we need to go for still more?
Fahad, the point that I'm trying to make too is that these are different businesses. So in case of the end customer who's signing up for refilling, you are the refiller, you buy the, and you're not concerned with the manufacturer, right? You buy packaged product, yeah. And you then open it and you repack for different people, right?
No, not that way. We can say we are getting the bulk and we are refilling in a retail manner.
Fair enough. So you're getting it in bulk from maybe not large brands, small brands, you're refilling it and providing,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So from customer's perspective, you are the brand. Right?
Yeah, we can say, we are the brand or we are a service provider, basically. We are not rebranding into our white labeling. We are giving it the same brand name.
So let us say if you bought it from, and I'm just using
Bipro a name. Or somebody.
You bought it from MTR, right? You bought a bulk packing from Bipro and you opened it and you packed it into 10 different customers' bottles. What is the brand he has bought? He has bought refill from you or he has bought Wipro refill from you?
Wipro refill from us.
Okay. Wipro. So he sees you as a refiller.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. As a refiller, he sees you largely because he is environmentally conscious and he wants to go sustainable, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. So basically, he's somebody who's saying, I trust you for
exactly,
refilling.
Exactly, that will be the initial customers.
He's saying, I trust you for refilling. Then 75 is a very small number.
Yeah, so what will be the ideal numbers?
So I would actually, more than ideal numbers, I would focus at what rate are you growing. For example, can you keep a sustained 5 to 10% growth rate per annum, per month? That is, you're adding at least 5 to 7 customers every month, 5 to 7 end buyers,
okay.
Consumers every month.
Okay.
You have, then that is a good traction and you can get funded.
Okay. So instead of focusing on the numbers, that will be the criteria to focus.
Focus on growth.
Yeah, got it.
Okay, we have time for a couple of more questions.
Thanks, Ravi. That makes sense.
Yeah, Joydeep has a question. How do we decide to give how much stake we should share with investor at seed stage?
Joydeep, we covered this. We said that unless you have figured out your financial plan and a equity devolution plan, there is no straight answer to this. If you have a business plan, you would have a financial plan. If you have a financial plan, you would know how much money you need at different stages, where it's going to come from. If you realize you figured it out and all normal sources have told you, sorry, we cannot be funding that stage, you'll have to go to somebody at that stage. At that stage, you'll have to figure out what is the value of the company. And there are valuation methods available. And you could figure out value, and based on how much money you need and the value that you have agreed upon with the investor, a percentage will be given. There is no, you can't think about it this way. Okay, I will decide, I will give 10% and I want 10 crores. It doesn't work that way. For you to give 10% for 10 crores, you must be valued at 100 crores. It's very simple maths. So decide that way. Decide, okay, what is the value of my business, which the investor will agree upon. And from there, you can figure out how much money you need and what percentage you have to give. Guys, don't treat it as negotiation. It is science.
I think we are at, yeah.
Okay.
Last question, if anybody has.
How to further get connected with you?
I think just reach out to Sudhir.
So we will send out messages to all of you with our contact details and the YouTube channel as well. So we could connect from there.
Sure. Great. Thank you so much, Ravi, Sudhir, Timbo.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Thank you very much, all of you. And then whoever has any specific questions or specific support that you need, we can get in touch one-on-one and then we can discuss further. Okay. Thank you very much for your time. Thanks, Ravi, sir, for all your insights once again. And hope to see you soon, all of you again. Thank you very much.
Bye, guys. Bye.
Bye.
Right, thank you.